Hello, everyone. Welcome back to another live Q&A. I'm Mark Holthe, Canadian immigration lawyer. And this is the Canada Immigration Live Q&A. Today's usually, I guess I would call it more the express entry Q&A, but we will see how, we'll see how the questions go. We always open it up so you can ask me anything you want. It's great to be back. I'm excited to do another live. We've had a few little surprises. We see back here, if I flip my screen around, let's see if we can get this working here. So if we go back to here, you can see you find folks that that we had on August the 15th, a no program specified draw. That was quite surprising. So 4,300. And the loaded question always, please, you know, let me know who's here. And don't hesitate to post, to give a shout out, indicate where you live in the world. I love to see that and give people little recognition for staying up so late to connect. But ultimately, you can see here that what is noticeably absent from this, you know, what's noticeably absent as I scroll through all of this into last year, and I keep going all the way back, 2022, all these PNPs to September 14th, 2021. Canadian experience class 2000, the low score is 462. And I'll just scroll back up here and you guys tell me what's missing. I'm obviously showing you stuff that you guys already know, but what, I'll turn on my audio here a little bit more. So what is missing from here? What do you see? What's missing? Exactly. There are no Canadian experience class draws. And I have tweeted this to the minister. I wonder if I can maybe even pull up, I don't know if it'll work. Let's see if I can pull this up here. Some of my previous comments. Let's see if I can go back here. I should probably retweet the other one. Okay, so there's my live. Great. Let's see if I can find here. Okay, here we go. So this is something that I wanted to point out specifically. So this is on Twitter here. So the minister, our fine friend right here. Okay, so this is what he tweeted, and Minister Miller tweeted the following, which I think was pretty. It was a poor decision to do so. He said, "Worth the read for anyone who didn't believe it was nonsense in the first place." So Pierre Poilievre, who is he's the leader of the Conservative Party, says new immigrants are warning people off Canada. He said, "But are they?" That's what Mark Miller is saying. And so my response here with many of the quotes and the responses, I'm just going to take a quick step back here. My response was, Minister, they are. Please do not put blinders on. Yes, the vast majority are so grateful to be here. However, there's a growing segment, particularly within the PGWP ranks, that are very disillusioned with Canada because they rightly feel Canada immigration has failed them. And of course, when I made this comment, you know, there's a lot of people just like you, you know, acknowledge that, you know, that they are, you know, you guys fall into that category, many of you. And you're asking all the right questions, right? So I just wanted to point that out because I thought, yeah, like, especially the minister, okay, let's pull him back on here. Minister Miller, like you really, really need to understand your portfolio before you make comments like that. And I know it's political, right? I know that, you know, the conservatives are trying to point out all the problems that the liberals are doing. That's their job, you know? And when the conservatives were in power, the liberal government would do everything they can to discredit and embarrass the other party. So stupid, the whole process. Personally, I wish you guys would all just represent the constituents who elected you and do your very best to serve their needs, not just do everything you can to try to keep getting elected. And personally, the liberal government has made some stupid decisions over the last while that have put the whole immigration system in the situation it is right now. I'm a big proponent of refugee work, asylum, but my goodness, you know, the decisions they made to bring in the volumes that they did all at once without a strategic plan and resources to handle it have overtaxed all the other areas. And that's why we're seeing so many problems right now. including with the permanent resident possibilities for international students. And now what is the minister talking about right now? Like there are some, I wonder if I can, I'm trying to think if I can find the post. It was probably Tamara who posted it. Tamara, my good friend here. Let's see if I can find, let's see here. I wonder if I have Tamara here. Oh, you guys probably know Tamara. I'm doing the wrong thing here. I'm trying to search instead of this. Okay. Miller International Student Caps. Let's see if that we pull up something this way here. Oh, guess not. I guess they don't. maybe I can't find any tweets on this topic. Here it is. Okay, so this is, I'm going to share my screen here so that you guys can see this. Sorry, I was flipping around. I'm going to share my screen. I wonder how long I've been going here without without flipping my screen over. Bear with me, guys. It's one of those days. So this article here in the Toronto Star, you know, Canada's post-secondary education sector is pushing back on a proposed cap on international student admissions, arguing it won't help address the country's current housing crisis, but threatens the economy. So you can see here, they've got Minister Fraser here, but Miller's really the one that's on the hot seat. So these types of discussions now are starting to happen because there are so many international students who no longer have a pathway to permanent residence, at least a meaningful one. And that's what I was talking to, that's what I was talking to Minister Miller about, at least in trying to communicate with him through this, you know, this process that we have right now, which is, I guess it's Twitter is the only way I have to communicate with him. But anyways, I just wanted to bring those things up because they're real. And like I said, in my Twitter posts, my heart breaks for you guys because you were sold a bill of goods. You were sold that there would be pathways to PR. And all that Minister Fraser did was kept kicking you guys down the path. Here's another 18-month post-grad. Here's another 18-month, hoping that that would be enough to get you guys drawn. Well, when they made the decision to open it up to French and to give all those bonus French points, that also really, really skewed the scores and made it increasingly difficult. And now, what, a million people applied for the open COET work permit? And 10,000 H-1B work permits have been all scooped up, right? And so all of them are flooding in to compete for those same spots. So yeah, my heart breaks for all of you. Okay, let's jump into, I see some questions coming here. Let's give some shout outs to people who are connecting in. I can see there's lots of questions that are coming in and I will get to those absolutely. Wagner, abraços to you too. He says, abraços, meu amigo. It's good to see you, my friend. Thanks for connecting in. Daniela says, hey, Mark, hope you're doing well. I always look forward to your live sessions every Wednesday. Greetings all the way from Congo. Hey, it's great to have you connecting in. That's awesome. And yes, Ramat, I'll post yours right now. CECs are deprived the most right now. Individuals that are in that category. I agree. Let's see what else we have here. And if you haven't had a chance, please do post where you're tuning in from. The summer has got people going in every direction. And yeah, I know usually these things start to ramp up in the fall again. Good to see you, Manu. Thanks for connecting in. And let's see what else we have here. Looks like people have got lots of questions posted. So we'll just dive into the questions here. Let's see here. Okay. All right, let's start right from the beginning. So we'll go back and remember with these questions, I'm not sure exactly how far this is reaching. If it is getting out to LinkedIn or some of the other channels, we'll just have to see. I know it's over on Twitter. Anyways, welcome everybody. And yeah, let's dive right into it. Okay. So Amara says, after getting the AOR, could the main applicant whilst on a valid closed work permit apply immediately to get a bridging open work permit? What are the stage for R10? Okay, so Amara, it really depends. So it depends on whether or not you have a job offer associated with that work permit, because closed work permits, remember, those work permits often are tied to job offers with those extra points. So when you say after getting the AOR, while you're on a valid closed work permit, can you apply immediately to get a bridging open work permit? It depends. And I'd need more information, Amara, in order to be able to advise you on that. And I definitely don't want to advise someone to go without understanding the full context and make an actual decision to change status. So I recommend that you book a consult, slide over to our firm website and just over to here and click on speak to a lawyer and book a consult and we can chat about that. Okay, let's go back here. All right, that is weird that it's showing up there. Let's just take this and I'm going to delete that. Okay, let's see who's next here. Okay, Yari says, hello, Mark. To enter my French language test, they asked me to enter the 7 digits after the hyphen, but mine consists of 8 digits. Is this normal? I don't know. That's unusual. Yeah, I'm not sure, Yari, about that one. We need to take a look at it. I need to see which French test that you took. Typically when I have any situation where I'm just uncertain, if it allows you to enter the information in, then a letter of explanation, including a copy of the actual language test result, is often what I do if I run into a problem that, you know, for some reason the instructions they give seem outdated or there's some new change. Like often we'll see instructions on the IRCC website for police clearances for certain countries. And then you'll start to follow the process and you'll find out that that country's actually changed their process. Well, in those situations, letters of explanation are kind of like the secret sauce, right? All right. Okay. Marco says, hey, to verify self-employment, normally a labor letter is enough as requested. A reference letter, I think is what you're talking about, is enough as requested by EE. Hours, salary, duties. I work by contract for the mayor of my city. I have pay stubs as well. Yeah. So you're going to want to try to provide every single thing that you can to prove all those same things that would normally be included in a reference letter. If you're working on a contract basis, you can still count it as long as you can demonstrate that you were doing all those things, that you were working full time, that the duties that you were performing were all consistent within the same NOC if it's outside of Canada, and that you were paid and, you know, the duties align with the NOC code that you've chosen. So you just have to work a little bit harder, Marco. Okay. If tech says NOI, OINP, during, okay, this is where we run out of space, right, with characters. During proof submission, can I not include the work period for which I am not claim points for within the same company, include them in other activities, trying to keep consistent with the e-profile? Well, you can. Like they're not going to block it if tech, they're not going to block it. If you want to include some other information, they're not going to reject your application for trying to keep it consistent with Express Entry. Okay. Okay. Prac Vice. 4 variations of name in previous passport, spelling, missing salutations, got the same name affidavit. Do I need to upload passport which has the previous names while submitting the OINP application? So then where? Okay, so when it comes to names and things like that, I always work off of the current one, the current passport. If there are variations in supporting documents that I'm including, then a letter of explanation to explain that, hey, this is me. Ultimately where to upload it. There is a section within the OINP where you can upload, you know, additional information essentially. And, if you wanted to, you could do it in that spot, but you need to explain the context, but the OINP really doesn't get too fussed about that stuff. It's only if you have, any discrepancy in the supporting documents that you're including with your current valid passport. Then on the IRCC side, previous names, you're going to talk about that. And once again, once you say you've used a previous name, even if you didn't use it, but it was a mistake, you might want to just list that name and then it will open up in your document checklist a place for name change, even though it wasn't a name change. And then you can explain all of it and say, hey, there's lots of errors on my previous passports. I've included the data page for each of those passports so you can see, but I'm one and the same. And this current passport has my correct actual full name. That's how I deal with that. All right, human. I paid a family biometric fee, 2 persons, but I'll be the only study visa applicant. Can I get a refund? Well, maybe. You just have to reach out to IRCC and there are mechanisms in place for getting refunds. IRCC refund process for immigration fees. Let's see if we can find it here. Yeah, it's pretty straightforward. So if you just Google it, you can find it. Man, it keeps pulling these up in here. This is really irritating. Let's see if I can pull this back into here. There we go. I think we're okay now. Let's see. So here you can see, this is the site that you go to asking for a refund of your, fee. So you can see the factors, how you paid, if you already applied, what you applied for. So you can easily pull that one up. Okay. the grace of God. Wonderful. Hey, Mark, I am a Nigerian studying nursing in the UK. Want to know, do I have a chance to move to Canada? Is there a step-by-step was to apply in the next 2 to 3 years? So this is a good segue for everybody. Remember, you guys, if you're tuning in for the first time, my goodness, why does it keep posting it in that? Oh, that's so irritating. Okay, we'll drop this off. So you can see the Canadian Immigration Institute that I have here has the Express Entry course. And I strongly encourage you guys to connect to this and and to subscribe to the course. In here, I have a ton of content that literally walks you step by step exactly what you're asking there through the whole entire process. And we have periodic masterclasses. And once you subscribe once, you can come back to, you know, future masterclasses. At this stage, we have kept them open. I may change it in the future, but at this stage, if you can't attend a masterclass on a certain date, you can come back and attend one in the future, even if you've subscribed to the course previously. So right now we have it open. Now I might change in the new year, but as of this stage, it's all open. So when you purchase it, you have access to these course materials that you subscribe to for life, as well as the ability to come back and ask questions in future masterclasses. So I strongly encourage you to slide over there and take care of that. Okay. Boy, I wish I could figure out why the heck this is showing up in both windows. We'll sort it out later. Okay. Sam says, hey, Mark, is the credit card statement sufficient to show that my sibling is living in Canada? Bank statement. Is there a phone? Is there something else? It's a factor. I would definitely, if you have something else, I would, you know, is there a lease agreement, like a rental agreement or something like that? Sometimes I'll include that. So maybe, but I'd often, you know, you could have a bank, you know, you could have a bank statement as well, but it may be. Okay, Nirvana says, my status still shows in progress for my H-1B open work permit. Any idea how long could it take to get responses? Well, they've told us up to 60 days, right? And as far as processing of the H-1B, so it's well within the time so far. Let's just pull it up and let's just see what comes up here. Okay, so right now it's showing 3 weeks, but I think it's a little bit higher. So it's showing about 3 weeks processing right now, but I think it's still a little bit higher. Although they are working through these as fast as they can. All right, next question. All right. Okay, IFTEC says, should I mention only my master's in education and not mention bachelor's, but move it to other activities as Wes gave back to my master's degree, but CS gave master's. That is tough. IFTEC, I recommend that you book a consult. I know you've got a lot of questions about this OINP. I've helped 3 or 4 people just this last week with their OINP applications who received the notifications of interest. When it comes to this, I recommend that you book a consult, IFTEC. You've got a couple of different things. You've got different Wes. Interesting. Wes gave the bachelor's and master's, but CS gave the master's. I see what you're saying. Wes gave a bachelor's equivalent to your master's, but CES gave the actual master's. Yeah, book a consult. We'll need to chat about that one. Okay, Wagner says primary occupation. On the Express Entry profile, it is asked the date first obtained the minimum education, how to proceed for NOCs that a degree is usually required. The minimum education can be, you know, pretty much anything. If it says usually required, that's not a mandatory requirement. Usually required means that, you know, normally it is, but it's not mandatory. And so the minimum education could even be high school for you. Yeah. Okay. And Wagner says, I've been working as a web developer for more than a year, but with no degrees related to the area. Should I inform my conclusion of high school? I'm not quite sure what you mean by that. Remember, for proving work experience, the education requirements, employment requirements don't apply. So if you're claiming foreign work experience, all they look at is the duties and responsibilities that you performed. And, you know, did you do all the things you need that IRCC wants you to do to claim that foreign work experience? That's really what it comes down to. So in your situation there, just because you don't have a degree, lots of web developers don't, but it's not mandatory to have that if you're, you know, claiming foreign work experience. All right. Okay. Okay, if I didn't graduate from my university in Canada but want to return back, is there any chance I need to add that to my application when applying to come back to Canada? Well, you're definitely going to explain it. You're absolutely going to include that in there because they'll be able to see it in your history. Okay, Newton, I'm actually going to take my screen here and I'm going to adjust this just a little bit so we have a little bit more room here to chat. Okay, so Newton says, this may not be expressed entirely, but would you have an idea of why AOS nominations are not happening? Well, it's all comes down to volume, right? So the Alberta Opportunity Stream, I'm assuming AOS is what you're going for, Alberta. And are you talking about applying through the AOS and just not getting a nomination yet? When you look at the province, we always look at, let's go here to the Alberta Advantage Immigration Program, my hometown here, and let's pull it up. And then we're going to look here at the processing times and inventory. And I'm going to share my screen with you. Take this off. Okay. So when we go into here and we look at this, the following numbers are accurate as of literally yesterday. So let's take a look. So summary of allocations. So non-express entry allocations, 4,875. Express entry allocations, 4,875. And so this is total allocations, 9,750. Okay. And so they've issued 6,921 so far in 2023. So there is still room for them to be issued. But remember, we have a number of different streams in here. And some of the ones that are actually taking off, you know, the Alberta, like the rural renewal stream has taken up quite a few spots that normally weren't. You know, the entrepreneur streams are, you know, there's a few there. They're basically dividing it up, right? So it may be that through this process, the process for the Alberta Opportunity Stream, that maybe they're closer to this than they originally expected and that it filled up faster. So they might be just slowing down the actual approval just because of the volumes that have come in, which is usually what happens. All right, let's keep zipping through here. Okay, Canva's World says, hey Mark, does IRCC compare old personal data documents which I submitted for visit visa with the new documents I've submitted for express entry? It is entirely possible that they could do that. All of the documents are a part of your record. And if an officer has any doubts or questions about something, they can always go back and look at previous applications if they feel the need to. And if they do and they find that there's discrepancies in the information, then it could cause them to question or choose not to accept information as being genuine in your current application. And in some worst case scenarios, they could even allege misrepresentation can be. So I recommend you, as always, with this type of sensitive information, I recommend you book a consult and the links are all below. Okay. There's a ton of NOI stuff and I'm going to try to get to everybody. I've answered a number of questions from some of the same people. So if you had a couple of questions answered, we're probably going to, I'm going to pass through and try to hit everybody here. Okay, so Heal says, hey Mark, hope you're doing well. Can you add video for how to add a spouse in an approved open work permit application for H-1B visa holders in the H-1B course? As soon as I hear about it, absolutely, I will do a video on that topic. Okay, let's see here. Okay. Davina says, hey, sir, may I ask you a question, please? After medical, how long does it take to get the biometrics and eventually the passport request? Well, it really depends on the type of application you're submitting. In some cases, the biometrics come very closely after submitting the application. When it comes to the actual passport request, it really depends on the type of application, which I'm not sure. If you are wondering about processing times, you guys, I'll slide over here and I'll just show you again. It's pretty simple. Just type in IRCC processing times into your Google and it will allow you to pull this up. And then when it comes to permanent residence, just go to economic immigration is usually the permanent resident categories you're applying through. And then choose the one that applies. If you're outside of Canada and you're going through the federal skilled worker program, then you're going to click on skilled workers federal and check processing time. And so this is really, really fast. So this is dropped significantly from before when it was over, 12, 13, 14 months. We're down to 5 months. Last updated 2 days ago. Okay. And then if we go here and we choose Canadian experience class for in Canada, this one is, it's actually gone up to 5 months. So now it was at 4 months and now they're kind of evened up at five. Okay. So that's where I go to get my processing time data. Okay, let's see who is next. Leon. Hey, Leon. Thanks for connecting. Hey, Mark, got my H-1B open work permit stamped 2 weeks ago. Thanks for all your help to this community. You're very welcome, Leon. That's awesome. All right. Okay, Prashant says, hey, should I make an express entry profile with a CRS score of 419, losing points for H? I know many people are in that situation. Do you think I can receive Alberta or Ontario PNP nomination with a score and knock one job profile? I'm assuming a tier one is what you're talking about. Anything is possible. And I no longer do I tell people or discourage people from applying. Anytime someone can get an application into the pool, I tell them there's no harm in doing it. And then in the interim, you try to find a job in Canada where you can come and work. That's really the pathway for people with lower human capital and lower CRS scores because of their age. Okay. Daniela says, I have a notification of interest in my express entry profile for New Brunswick, but I don't know what to do next. Is an NOI same as PNP? Yes. This is the province of New Brunswick inviting you to submit an application through their express entry stream. So Danielle, if you have questions, I recommend you book a consult, but you need to get on that right away because these are very time sensitive. And this is a huge thing because it says basically we're interested in you, Danielle. So submit your application to New Brunswick and we will consider giving you a nomination, which is absolutely PNP. So if you have questions, don't hesitate to book a consult with me. Like I said, the links are below. Myself, Igor, Alicia, any of us can help. But don't delay. This is actually a good thing, Daniela. Okay. Okay. Shahid says, hey, Mark, I want to start my application process. Do I need to first get the document attested or should I start the application parallel? Well, understand that if you want to start an express entry application, the first things you need is your educational credential assessment and your language test results. Those are two, although the language test alone would be enough to get you to submit your profile if it was express entry, you absolutely want your education assessed. Otherwise, you're not going to get any points for them. And then you can start right away. And then as far as the other documents and things that you're including, and I don't know if you're starting the filing of your EAPR, your electronic application for permanent residence, the second part of express entry, or Shahid, whether you are, starting the first process of just submitting your profile. But language test, education assessment, and then you can enter that profile. And then as far as the other documents, it just depends on how long you think it's going to take to get those documents, the stage at which, when you start requesting them. And also, it depends on whether or not you think you're going to get an ITA right away or not. Okay. Camby says, yes, the continuous full-time employment. I agree. I've had work with other people. I remember one individual that I helped quite a few years back now, probably about 4 or 5 years ago, was also worked on ships. And fortunately for him, he had one year that he was able to include, which was enough to get him eligible through the Federal Skilled Worker Program. And remember, Camby, if you can meet the eligibility for the Federal Skilled Worker Program with just the 1 year of continuous, then you can include bits and pieces of your other, you know, 4 or 5 or 6 month segments of work while you're on the ocean. You can bundle all of those together to make the remaining 3 years to maximize your comprehensive ranking system. But if you can just hit the 1 year, and if that's enough to allow you to meet the 67 points out of 100, and that's a good segue. I want to share with you guys our blogs. So if you haven't gone to our website and clicked on our blogs, please do that. You will see here that Igor did a great little blog post here on the points that you need for FSW and how that interplays with Express Entry. Because the FSW program has its own point system, and many of you don't even know about it. You're not aware that there's an assessment going on in the background to ensure that you're eligible to enter in the pool. And one of those is that you have the 67 points out of 100 on the FSW scale. Once you're in the pool, then they rank you based on the comprehensive ranking system's 1,200 points. So if you haven't had a chance to go check that out, go check out Igor's article. Great post, and it can really help to clarify a lot of things. Okay. Daniela says, which one is faster, going through PNP or just wait for French stream? Daniela, I would do both. I always do. Start the process, and whichever one wins, wins. But then you have two horses in the race, not just one. And sometimes horses, you know, injure themselves when they're racing, right? Maybe you submitted the wrong document. Maybe you made a mistake, and immigration is ruthless. Let's say you file your PNP application. It's in the queue, and then you get an ITA and submit your express entry application. Well, maybe you get that ITA and you submit it, and immigration rejects it because they don't believe you've actually got the work history you've claimed. Well, then you're back in and your other PNP application is still underway. Now, with that being said, some provinces like Ontario, the moment they know you've got an ITA, if it's an express entry stream, they will say, hey, we see that your profile is locked, which means you've got an ITA. Therefore, are you going to cancel that ITA and continue with us? Or do you want to discontinue your OINP application? And that happens sometimes. But I always push it, and I keep every option open as much as I possibly can. I never want to restrict myself. Okay, Prazaval says, I haven't gotten an update on my H-1B work permit yet. Do you think it is rejected? I think I was one of the last people to apply late on Monday night, next day from San Francisco. It's hard to say, Prazaval. But you will get, as long as your email address and everything is correct, then you'll get a notification of that rejection. They don't just go silent. They will tell you. Hopefully that's not the case. Okay, Hardy says, greetings from Chicago, my friend. Good news, I got the H-1B Canada permit approved. Just need to send it to the VFS. Awesome. Congratulations, Hardy. Oh, let's get one of these in there. Oh, here I've got, I got to turn up the volume on my sound effects here. Here we go. Here it comes. Congratulations, Hardy. That's awesome. And thanks for being a part of the journey, right? That was pretty crazy. Okay, Daniela says, when submitting documents, must one submit all stamps? And these questions, you guys, are all of them. The vast majority, I don't know if any of these have not otherwise been included in the Express Entry course. So this is a complete step-by-step that walks you through every aspect of the course. And you can subscribe, like I said, right now. If you scroll down to the bottom here, you can see the structure of the course. There's over 10 hours of content. And then I say 4 hours of live masterclass, but the reality is the masterclass sessions, which will probably start in September, are you can come to as many as you want in the future. So this is almost, you know, at least at this stage for the time being, you can come back and attend other masterclasses for other cohorts of people who are subscribing. So if you're doing Express Entry and you haven't subscribed for this course, you are stupid. Do it, because it is chock full of everything that you guys are looking for. And it will help you avoid those common mistakes and set you up for just really submitting a solid application. Okay. Let's see what else we have here. Yeah. And there's a lot of people, Stubum. How to apply for wife if got approved for H-1B open work permit. Previously, they given link, but now it's not available. I know, that's the question. We have not yet seen any feedback on this. just so horribly. You know, this was a product of Minister Fraser here, but then right in the midst of it, you know, Minister Miller had to take over. But this is an example of just, you know, Minister Fraser rushing to do some program and take advantage of the tech frenzy, and then not really having in place the system to do it. And I had huge issues with that. And, you know, if I go to the Canadian Bar Association, let's see here. I'm just going to see if I can pull this up. Let's see if I can pull it up here so you guys can see this immigration section submissions. So these are submissions and resolutions that the Canadian Bar Association has submitted. So money, limitation, chairperson, appointment of associate chief judge, review chairperson, pure path to out of status. Did they not even have it up here yet? Maybe it was too new. Maybe because I was sure that we had sent it over. Yes, it looks to me like they don't have it up here yet. Guess they're taking their time. Anyways, I gave the CBA and both the CBA and CELA, which is the Canadian Immigration Lawyer Association. Let's see if we have publications for them as well. I gave them both a top 10 list of problems with the program articles here, our latest releases. This is a little bit easier to find. Let's see if we have it here. Okay, here, this one right here. So, yeah, so I provided a lot of, you know, structure and content for this submission that they, you know, that they posted. This is basically the foundation of my top 10 list that I created, which was all designed to just give some feedback to the government on how awful this process is. So when everything's said and done, Shubham, the moment I hear, I will definitely do something. Okay. Okay, Sam. Hey, good to see you. If a person has applied for PR under the PNP, just in case it gets an ITA, probably through Express Entry, can he apply PR under Express Entry? Absolutely, absolutely. Now, the PNP may, you know, depending on what stage you're at with the PNP, if they haven't yet issued the nomination, you know, sometimes that will halt and they'll say, hey, wait a minute, I see you're going through Express Entry. I don't want to waste my nomination on you because you already have an ITA. But in other cases, if you've applied through one of the old paper-based, you know, through the PR portal for your PNP, there's nothing stopping you from going through Express Entry at the same time. The only thing you can't have at the same time in Canada for applications is you can't sponsor more than one person at the same time. So you can't sponsor your spouse and your parents at the same time for permanent residence through the family class. Okay. Srinivas. Hey, Mark, I got my application for open work permit for H-1B visa holders approved. Thank you so much for your videos. How long would it take to get my passport from VAC? It happens really quick. And you guys that are on there, hey, okay, there we go. You will get passport in 2 weeks. Great. Thanks, Sam. I was just going to say, you guys, how long did it take you? I had both of my consults this morning, just so you guys know, are both individuals that had their approvals just like you, Sam and Srinivas. We're talking about PR strategy for them. So just book a consult. If you guys have questions, where do we go? If you have questions about what to expect with your work permit strategies, now's the time to book the consult as you're starting to now seriously consider Canada as an alternative. Okay. Let's see what is next here. Okay, I'll just pull this up for Tuba. We've got LinkedIn. Thanks for connecting in on LinkedIn, Tuba. So my IELTS scores are 5.5 in reading, listening 7, speaking 6, writing 7. Am I eligible for Express Entry? Yes. Express Entry requires that your minimum language scores are at least, and it comes down to which program you're going through, Tuba. I'm going to assume you're outside of Canada. In that case, it's a Canadian language benchmark of 7 is the minimum. And let's see here, language equivalency tables, IRC, CEE. Let's see if we can find this and we'll talk about this. So you've got a score of 5.5 in reading. So let's slide over here and let's take a look. And it was the IELTS that you went through. So we'll jump down to IELTS. So you can see here that you can see here for it was reading 5.5. So for reading, you have a 5.5 and you need a 6. And I can see the distinction here, but you know, why would they not? Is it here or here? So a 5 or higher is still going to keep you at a level 6. Once you hit a 6 here, then it will bump you up to the minimum level 7 for the federal skilled worker program. And that's probably what you're at. If you were in Canada under the Canadian Experience class, then a minimum 5 all the way down here. If you're a tier 3, you know, basically a tier 3, then, you know, it's as low as that. So keep that in mind. Good question. Haven't had that one for a while, Tuba. This is really hard, Ross. As an international student, do you think it's best to study French after graduating? Or my spouse tier 4 now? I don't have hope for express entry category specific since my program, work after graduation, is not on the list. It doesn't hurt. In fact, Ross, if you have any questions about whether or not you're actually going to get that ITA, it does not hurt to study French. Yep, Subham, I see all of that about family. Yes, they indicated it. It's just brutal. Okay, Patrick says, is it possible that we get the provincial nomination before we actually move to Canada? We have companies supporting our U.S. green card. Safety to secure a PR is the priority for us. Thank you. Well, understand that if you've got a work permit, Patrick, if it's an H-1B work permit that's approved, and you're going through the process of applying, there's a number of different avenues that you can go through. And I'm bringing up the open work permit holders. It's not directly answering your question because many are asking this. There are programs and categories that will extend nomination to you without coming to Canada, but so many of them are so tied to job offers, right? Or work experience. So is it possible with human capital alone? Yes, it is possible that a province could identify you and and you could go through and get your nomination before you actually travel to Canada. It's possible, but those types of options are very few and far between. All right, who's next? Anyone who has their applications kind of hung up and they're past the regular processing times, I always do an access to information request to see if there's something else that's holding it up. Like it's sent for further review because they don't believe your work experience. Notion, if you want to book a consult, we can chat about that. But what I recommend is that you request the GCMS notes and see if there's something going on in the background. You can always call the call center and just see if there's something that you've somehow missed, if you can get through to the call center, but there isn't a lot that you can do. Okay. Rowan says, what's your prediction about immigration programs for next year? Will it be easier or harder? Oh boy. I think it's going to be about the same. I don't think the Liberal government really wants to wade into any other programs that are just further causing problems for the immigration department. At least I don't think so, unless there's election. If there's an election, then the Liberal government will definitely try to find some other humanitarian thing to pursue because that's what they do during elections, you know, and it's very effective because Canada, you know, we want to be a country that's humanitarian in nature, that cares about the global community and people that are suffering in other countries and being a safe haven, 100% on top of it. But the manner in which they've done it is just really, really tough because it's completely overtaxed the immigration department. And my goodness, I don't know how or why I would ever want to work for the department these days. It's just unbearable as an officer trying to process and all of these huge, you know, big announcements with no infrastructure in place to do them. And it's really tough, really tough. Okay. Spider-Man. Hey, good to see you from Montreal. I'm heading to Quebec in November, Spider-Man. I am presenting to the Acadie, the Quebec Immigration Lawyer Association, on pathways for permanent residence for people who don't see options in Quebec. So it'll be fun to go out there. I'm not going to be in Montreal, but one of the resort places. I think that's where they're holding the conference. Okay. um, Okay. Sahil says, hey, Mark, with targeted draws in Canada's housing shortage, is there any chance for architects with 430, 440 points in express entry this year? If it's just pure human capital and you don't have any other connection to Canada, Sahil, I think it's unlikely. Okay, let's see what is next here. Anatoly, thank you for connecting, and I wish you all the very best over there in London, England as well. Thank you. Okay. Louay says, hello, I'm a fresh high school graduate and I want to immigrate to Canada. What is the best pathway for me if I don't have more than 7,000 US? Well, I would have told you studying is probably the best pathway for you, post-secondary studies, but you need sufficient funds to be able to support yourself. And if you don't have those, then it's unlikely your study permit's going to get approved. So in my mind, that's kind of the process. That's study permit is what I would direct you to. Okay, Nana says, does having a provincial nomination speed up the process of PR applications via the express entry route? If the PNP nomination is an express entry stream within that provincial nominee program that then allows you to submit through the express entry process, then it's lots faster than one that is not an express entry stream that goes through the regular PR portal process. Okay, Yukong says, hey, Mark, thanks for the live stream with open work permit. What's our best bet towards PR? I've had 2 years foreign experience and under 30. Does CEC require NOC 1-2 experience or any Canadian experience? Thank you. There's lots of miscommunication about that. People don't understand. Canadian experience class requires that you have worked in Canada for at least a year in the previous 3 years. So in every case, you're going to be coming to Canada if you want to go through CEC. Now, in terms of the best option, that's what I do, the consults. And so that's where I take this and I ring my little triangle here and I indicate to people, slide over to our firm website and click on speak to a lawyer right here and just connect with Alicia, myself, or Igor and book a consult. And we can then help you to actually strategize what options will be the best for you. Okay. All right. Yes, Riley, I can see you're posting it. Notice new changes happening in SDS student direct stream language requirements. Is it the same to other countries like Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka? Or what is the requirement for those countries? We will have to see. It's all new, Riley. We'll have to see as the things play out. When you start the application process, the document checklist will be updated to confirm exactly what the requirements are. And so it's still really new, but stay tuned. More information will come. Okay, Hardy says, have we seen a transportation draw? I have almost 3 years in manufacturing experience, which is the main knock, but I have but I have 1.5 of transportation experience. Can I still get picked? Well, remember, it's only 6 months that you need to show, right? So you only need 6 months of work experience in the previous 3 years and the most recent 3 years. And if you have that within your work experience, then you have the potential of being drawn. And no, we have not seen a construction draw yet. If we go back to the ministerial instructions here and I share my screen with you, you can see here that as far as the actual occupations, we had a trade one, we've had French, we've had healthcare, and we've had STEM. And that's it. So no construction yet. So we will see. We will see. Okay, I've got about 5 minutes more. I think I did see a super. Jatin says, STEM draw, FSW, 6 months experience should be in primary NOC. Okay, I think I just answered that one, right? So basically the answer, the 6 months doesn't need to be in the primary NOC. As long as it's anywhere within the 3 years and you've included in your work history, you can be drawn through that category-based draw. So your primary NOC could be something else, but as long as you have 6 months, continuous, full-time, skilled, paid work experience that's in that NOC, that's in your example, the STEM draw, then that's sufficient. Okay, let's see what else is cooking here. I'm going to jump over and it looks like we got another super. Since for Manu. We are just about finished, guys, so we're probably going to wrap this up. let's see here. Okay, Manu says, I need to show proof of funds for OINP. I have investment account funds and transferred funds from the investment account that is in my bank account for the past 1 month only. Is investment account acceptable? Manu, you want to provide a very clear explanation of where those funds came, the source, you know, the transfer that you made out. You want to explain all of that in a letter of explanation and provide as much information as possible and bundle it all into a PDF and then upload it together. Okay. So remember, funds, the key is that the funds are yours. And, you know, when they're asking for, you know, bank statements and things like that, you're going to provide as much information as possible just to show that you actually have it. So that's how I deal with it. Letters of explanation. Okay, let's see. We've got just four more minutes here and then we're going to wrap up. Let's see what's next. Sam says, I received my provincial nomination at the start of August and received an ITA last week. Sam, connect in, my friend, and subscribe to the course. I'd love to see you in the master classes, and it'll walk you through the whole process so that you're not missing anything, my friend. Okay, looks like people are jumping in with the supers now here. So let's see. So Wagner says, Mark, thanks for the answer. What I meant is, for the date first obtained the minimum education, should I inform the date I started working as a web developer or the date I graduated from high school? It doesn't really matter. IDRM, that's the response. So it doesn't really matter. Okay, let's see what else here. I'm going to pull up the YouTube. We've got some stickers that are being posted here. you guys are so funny. Let's just see. I'm just going to pull up the actual video because I can't see it within my software of the of what it looks like here. So, oh, here we go. I'm gonna pull it on just because I want to share. Okay, here we go. So this is, yeah, so this is family of eight here. Great, great to have you connecting in. That's awesome. Okay, back to Wagner here. So basically, for this, it doesn't really matter which date you use, you know, because essentially minimum education, it could be high school. Usually that's probably what I would do. You know, when it comes to web developer, often there's experience that you're going to have gained, right, to some extent. But when there is no real meaningful date, yeah, you can put the date you completed your high school. That's totally fine. The interesting thing is that the question really isn't designed for anything other than federal skilled trade program, but they were trying to design a question that captured federal skilled trade without having to create a whole separate page for it. So essentially it forces you to answer it, even though it really doesn't apply or really have any meaningful assessment process within the federal skilled worker or the CEC. So yeah, so it's fine if you want to put the date you completed high school, Wagner. That's totally fine. Okay, and then yes, we've got, all right, I'm going to answer your question, family of eight here. It says, please answer. I love that how it shows up here. Sticker, smiling face with sunglasses. Okay, and then face screaming in fear. That is so funny. It is so, so funny. Okay. I'm gonna pull this all up just because it's so funny. I love this. Okay. Right here. I'm going to pull this one up. That's the one that was actually posted. So big shout. I'm going to applause this because that is so cool. Okay. Now let's get to the questions of the family eight here. Just give me 1 second and we'll pull it up. Okay. Okay. Please answer this. I get an ITA, but I'm in the US with pending asylum. Would that be a problem? Not necessarily, but you definitely have to disclose everything. Is a pending asylum in the US will affect the PR application? I got my ITA. I recommend that you book a consult, actually, is what I recommend. Please, pending asylum status in the US, I got my ITA. Would that affect my PR application? As long as there's no inadmissibilities and things like that, then you know, obviously you can continue forward and you can submit your application. But I strongly, strongly recommend, I'm pending, no interview, no court. Yes, got it all. So yeah, I recommend you book a consult. We can actually map out your strategy. Congratulations on getting the ITA. I think that's great. It's great. And, but we can dive through it and we can look at it, but the key is absolutely disclosing everything. Okay, looks like we are at the tail end here. I don't think I have any more supers here that I've missed. Super sticker, beaming face with smiling eyes. I got to figure out a different way of pulling this up because just because the way it's structured here. Let's see if I can find it. Now I'm trying to find all of the comments that you find folks are posting here. I'm going to pull up. Looks like we've got here. Just hang on. Maple's view. Oh, I know. I see why. Okay, here we go. Because I did a super search. I'm just going to pull this one up. Okay, so we'll pull up the Maples view. I initially started my work on my open work permit and completed 1 year with my present company. Now my work permit conditions has changed to close work permit. Can I claim 50 points? Possibly. It depends on if the company is willing to support you with a job offer. And that job offer is for the purposes of express entry. So there's a letter involved with it that says they will employ you for at least 1 year after you become a permanent resident. And ultimately, when you're on a closed work permit, you have to be able to, you know, you have to be able to obviously demonstrate that you meet the requirements. But yeah, when you've, it says you have to have shown that you've worked for that employer for at least 1 year. Now, okay, let me take a step back. I see where you're going here, Maples. And this is one of the challenging parts. This is the hard part of trying to answer with just limited information. Because then the tumblers in my mind are just kind of rolling, thinking, okay, what are all the different factors we have to take into consideration, right? And the reality is, when it comes to the 50 points, if we go to the actual, and I cover this in my Express Entry course as well. Okay, let's just pull it up here and look at it. So we'll take the dumbed down version. We'll use the government website. So what is an offer of employment? So as you go through here, you'll see, as you go down to the bottom here, yes, it's all of these things, okay? But this is the key here. And what you're talking about is a closed permit, right? So it's not LMIA. So if you have a valid work permit, okay, that is exempt from needing an LMIA, and you are currently working for an employer specified on the work permit. So that would probably be check. Have 1 year of full-time work experience or an equal amount in part-time for that employer. Well, technically you do, right? Have a valid job offer from that employer for at least 1 year after we issue PR. Well, maybe you do. So it may very well be possible for you to go down that path and to claim those extra points. But this here is a summary of the actual regulations. And I'll be honest, I'm not going to give you specific advice saying yes, 100% that you can do that, the Maples view. I recommend that you book a consult so that I can understand exactly what is happening. Okay. All right. I think we're going to need to, wrap it up there. Let's see here. Yeah, I think we're going to have to, I'll just check, make sure there's no more supers that I'm missing. Oh, there is one, X on Y. You guys, I need to wrap it up. I've got a staff meeting right now. Let's see if I can find this here. Okay. Hey, Mark, what do you think of the quotas revealed by the Globe and Mail for the remainder of the year, and where do you think that will send STEM scores to, if true? I'm assuming, did the Globe and Mail article just come out recently? I have not had a chance to read that yet, so I'll have to take a look and see, because I haven't read that yet. You guys, okay, who is next? Okay, Jatin says, please answer my question below. Okay, well, let's see, Jatin. Okay, received ONP, NOI, FSW, tech stream. There is a 1 week unpaid gap before completing 1560 hours because my studies in Canada had ended but had not applied for the postgrad. Would it be considered continuous? I don't think so. You need the full 1 year. I would never advise if you're even 1 week short. You know, in my mind, Jatin, I always take a conservative approach to that. It's challenging. 1 week unpaid gap before completing the 1560 hours because my studies in Canada had ended but had not applied for postgrad. Would it be considered continuous? So I guess the question is, what is continuous? Are you trying to count work experience while you were a student and then there was a 1 week gap and then you kept working? because obviously, you know, counting that work experience is a complicated thing, Jatin. And, you know, individuals, you know, you can't count work experience when you were studying in Canada and full-time attending full-time studies. So I recommend, Jatin, that you book a consult so that we can sort that out, because this is an area that causes a lot of confusion for people. Ultimately, if you have any doubts, here's how I give, and I really want to try to give valuable information, even though in many cases I can't be super specific. If you look at your situation and you're on the border of something, okay, and you think you could maybe make a case that something could work, but you're just not sure, then you look at what are the consequences of immigration disagreeing with me. So if you have no pathways to permanent residence and you feel like this is your only shot at it and you're right on the border, and the consequences of not filing are your time's going to expire in Canada and you're going to have to go home anyways, there's no harm in submitting an application and making the pitch. Now, you're going to fully disclose everything. You're not going to try to hide or conceal or misrep, but you're going to fully disclose. And, you know, it's possible in some cases, if you really, this is your last ditch effort. Sometimes I've seen people submit applications, disclose things, and officers give them the benefit of the doubt and it goes through. But each situation is different. And if there's backup plans or alternatives, then I will almost always wait and consider that backup plan. All right. Okay. I think we're going to wrap it up right there, guys. Let's see here. Yeah. I think we're going to, let's see. Did we get, I think I got Stephen's comment. Okay. Stephen, I don't want to miss yours. I have an expired visa in the US and living in the US. Do I need to prove legal status in the US when applying for express entry? If so, what other documents can provide proof of legal status? Okay. So if you've got an expired visa in the US and living in the US, are you out of status? Are you living illegally? You know, obviously, like Igor is an example of that. He had issues with his permit and we were able to fix it. So it may be possible, but once again, Stephen, I recommend you book a consult. And everything has to be disclosed. And so, proof of legal status. If your visa's expired, I'm not sure what alternative that you would include, but you definitely need to disclose things. Yeah. All right. We're going to wrap it up there. And thank you everybody for connecting in and such good questions. I'll be back at it tomorrow. Stephen, I got your super there. So, yes. So we'll be wrapping this up, but I'll be back tomorrow with Alicia at noon Mountain Time. And it was great to reconnect with everybody. Good luck with everything that's happening. So many changes, and we're waiting to see if we're going to have a round of invitation draw today. You know, at this stage, as of the end of this live stream, I don't see any changes in the round of invitations. It looks to me like we haven't yet had one, and you guys usually tell me within minutes of it happening anyways. So it looks like we're still sitting on the draw that happened last week. Same one. All right. Thanks, guys. Take care. And